Welcome to the ILSS online series by India Leaders for Social Sector. My name is Pratyush and I'll share a quick introduction about ILSS for those of you who are new to the community. We are a learning and leadership development organization for the social sector. We launched 2 years ago and our aim is to inspire, build and nurture leadership talent for the social sector. Our flagship program is the 9-day leadership program that aims to help senior corporate professionals to learn about and transition into the social sector. ILSS Online is our latest offering, wherein we bring to you thoughtfully curated sessions by some of the top social impact leaders, practitioners, academics, and policymakers like Osama. Also in the pipeline are programs for social sector professionals, which we'll be kickstarting with a course on fundraising professionals. We are inviting applications for our 9-day leadership program scheduled to take place in August this year. My colleagues will share a link to the program in the chat box. If you like today's webinar, do check our program. For today's session, I'm honored to introduce Osama Manzar to all of you. Osama is the founder director of Digital Empowerment Foundation. He's a global leader on a mission of eradicating information poverty in India. He sits on several government and policy committees in India and on international organizations, working in the areas of internet access and digital inclusion. He is the member of the Working Group on IT for Masters at Ministry of IT in India and various other committees and global fora. In these critical times, Osama's organization, DEF, is doing excellent work under the Digital Emergency Relief Program. Today, he is going to share with us his thoughts on the relief and humanitarian work in a hyper-connected world and also talk about the initiatives taken by DEF in response to this colossal humanitarian crisis. Welcome, Osama. We are so glad to have you with us today. The format for today's webinar would be that Osama will first present for 25 to 30 minutes. After that, we'll be opening the floor for questions. Please post your questions in the Q&A window and we'll take them up with Osama after the presentation. Thank you and over to you, Osama.
Thank you, Pratyush, and thank you, ILSS. I think we are habitual partners in discussing developmental issues in your cohort, this kind of cohorts. Welcome all the listeners and the participants who have taken out time in the late evening of lockdown 4.0. Lockdown has become more digital version than any Windows version, it seems. We had a discussion with ILSS that what kind of topic that we should talk about, what kind of issue that we should discuss. Doing humanitarian work in a hyper-connected world is a topic that we chose because it was very unexpected of the kind of organization that DEF is, that people would expect that we will be doing humanitarian work. You know, Digital Empowerment Foundation sounds like we all are digital. We have nothing to do with food, we have nothing to do with aid, and we have nothing to do with empathy and sympathy and so on and so forth. But it all turned out to be very different, and that's what we thought that we can share with you. So many of you might be knowing Digital Empowerment Foundation, but to just give you a little bit of background, we are an organization who is perhaps India's one of the largest well-networked organization as far as the physical footprint is concerned all over the country. We have about 600 plus locations where we are present with broadband connectivity, with digital foot soldiers, with digital devices and community resource centers and so on and so forth across 23 states and 130 districts. So we are pretty much all over the country, from where migration happens, from where poverty lives, where tribal population are high, where the people live with below poverty line and so on and so forth. Because all the districts that we target to work are backward districts by choice and by policy. So that's how we are built. And we have a foot soldier you know, what we call as digital foot soldiers, are almost 10,000 all over the country across these 600 locations also. That means these are the people who are very well equipped with digital devices. But more than that, they are very well digitally skilled to provide any kind of information through digital means. We didn't know that, you know, at this point of time, when the last 2 months, when the COVID attacked us and we gone into lockdown, most of the organization were unable to function. But we found ourselves that we are at the edge of being highly, you know, present locally, was becoming very, very strongly an asset to the organization. So we, rather than going fundraising and all that, we actually started working with our foot soldiers to get e-passes and, you know, and get a movement pass and start working, you know, to the aid of the people. So what I will do is that I will share, you know, 4 or 5 very strong examples that how it works. But before that, let me tell you what we call as hyper-connected world. Let me tell you that India is the most under hyper-connected world, you know. We are not, you know, we are less than 30% population or maybe 35% population who are internet connected. You know, what we call as hyper connected is actually India is not, because more than 550 million people in India still use feature phones and they do prepaid customers. And all these people are actually at the time of lockdown, at the time of financial crisis, at the time of economic crisis, is suffering from non-payment, or they are unable to make the payment, or while they are migrating, they are facing problem to connect with their people that they want. So this is very, very important in, you know, information for us to understand that when everybody has got mobile, what good it is for them to be connected and to be usefully connected. The second part is that what we call as you know, qualitatively connected, which is either by a smartphone or by internet, we don't have more than 400 to 500 million smartphone users in our country. And in that, more than 300 million are in urban areas and cities and metros. Less than 200 million are in rural areas. So you can imagine when the population lives in rural area, 70% plus, and all those urban area population who are migrants and who are laborers, who are informal sector, they all use feature phone. You can imagine how low penetration of smartphone. The second aspect of this hyper-connected world and its negative impact in India is that India somehow achieved a very strong digital enablement of all the services that is related to poor, right? Whether access to food, whether access to, you know, education or access to entitlements, and many of those things are all subjected to internet and digital, like e-governance. For example, you cannot access your ration without having a biometric device identify you, authorize you. But what is the negative impact of this one is the digital divide. Do we have enough number of people with that kind of digital infrastructure at the last mile who can access online facilitation of every service that they are entitled to? They are not. Do they have, or their panchayats or their corners or their community have access point which they can, you know, go and access? There is not. You know, the whole BharatNet thing to have all the panchayat 100 Mbps connected hasn't happened yet. So in a hyper-connected world where the services have been put in online, unfortunately, when you say that go and ration is being distributed, you cannot go and have ration because one, you are locked down, second, your ration card is not being used because you have said that Aadhaar identification, the POS machine is not allowed because it's a touch machine. Now it will be OTP oriented. When it is OTP oriented, I don't have either mobile or my old mobile number is with you, which doesn't work with me now. And if there is a new number, then I need a whole new process to access those things. So you can imagine the whole, in the digital world, how, you know, difficult it is when you don't have a digital infrastructure at the last mile. You all know that all the educational institutions are closed. Now, its negative impact is that the entire rural India's education is locked down and it's non-functional. You know, ILSS may run their online, you know, maybe webinars and all that. Ashokas can run. You know, your you know, well-paid schools can run. Private schools can run. You know, those people, those students who have money, they can have bandwidth and they can run. But what about 1.4 million schools of the country which is closed down? Their 7 million teachers are actually not available, and their 200 or 300 million students are stranded. You know, so what do we do? You know, what do you do? I mean, can you take this entire digital, you know, content to them, because there is no digital infrastructure to access, neither community-based nor individual-based. So these are very strong negative aspect that we are actually able to check at this point of time, that in a hyper-connected world where the world is half connected and half is still not connected, do we have a quality digital infrastructure? Do we have a quality digital individual infrastructure and access points? No, it is not. So keep that in mind. And then let's go back to see how our work has become a very strong example, which can be adapted nationwide, that digital infrastructure at a grassroots level would have helped. So for example, what we did in what we launched as Digital Emergency Relief Program, COVID Digital Emergency Relief Program, is that we alerted all the 5,000 to 10,000 digital foot soldiers that you are going to be the local leader for all the needs of the people. Number one, information as a need. Misinformation as fighting misinformation and fake news. You know, very, very important, because you know, COVID, at the time of COVID, misinformation has been flourishing like anything, you know. I mean, people are, you know, practicing like a dogma of anything, like doctors coming home and they're not allowing that. I mean, imagine in the villages what will happen. I would like you to invite and go and have a look at our website, which did a survey on misinformation, the kind of rumor that is spreading across. But that's number one. How do we enable people with information, right information, do's and don'ts, and how do we fight misinformation? So that's what we did. The second thing what we did is that we created a local kit of safety kit or a health safety kit for COVID. So there must be sanitizer, there must be, you know, masks, and that doesn't mean that you need to buy all the masks yourself. Your job is also to tell each and every household that what kind of mask you can use, how you can self-create masks, how you can, you know, internally in the household you can make a mask, how you can make masks for others also and distribute, and so on and so forth. So, you know, that's one. And that also help kit in terms of information. So WhatsApping everyone that what kind of, you know, preventive healthcare that you must take to avoid COVID at this point of time. The third most important thing is, how do we enable that everybody has access to food? Because, you know, the kind of villages that we work in, you are seeing a lot of migrants stranded, and they are suffering, and this is all over the news, all over the social media. You know, the whole country looks like that, walking on the road. But the point is, the distress in the villages, nobody talks about, because they are still, you know, bothered by this visible distress that is happening there. Even at a village level, there are hundreds of thousands of people who do not have access to ration properly, either because of they don't have a ration card, or even if they have a ration card, they don't have a means to leave the house and go and collect it. So how our food soldiers or digital food soldiers can enable onlining of them, you know, getting the paperwork done and get the food and the grains and everything dropped in their household. The fourth important thing is that government announced various kind of financial aid, you know, direct benefit transfer and all that. But how do you withdraw? Because if you're not going out of the home, So most of our people worked as a banking correspondent. So they had access to bank and they could withdraw the money for them and drop it to their doorsteps. So that happened a lot. Most of these foot soldiers also roamed around and started writing information on the walls of the villages and what are the preventive things. Like you must have seen in films here and there that in NREGA and in other things, in the villages, people usually write messages on the wall for mass awareness and things like that. They started using mic and do the announcement and going around. So that's what we did. And the fifth most important thing that happened, and that happened automatically, we did not really push it, is that out of 600 centers, almost 100-150 centers of ours started making masks. And not only masks for distributing free of cost locally, but also started making masks for selling it or on orders of pharmacy, local hospitals, local doctors, local government offices, and so on and so forth. And they have been earning money. Even the alternative entrepreneurship started being created, and they have started, which was great news at this point of time, because all the sources of earning money was actually not available to them. So these are some of the things we could do. Why we could do? Because we had a large network of people. So hyper connected in terms of human network. How we could do? Because they all are digitally enabled and digitally resourced and digitally connected. That's why they could do all the things online, coming and transfer it online. How they could do? Because they are all entrepreneurs and they are not paid. So they also know how to turn around various kind of necessities into opportunities and convert them into entrepreneurship. The two more examples that I wanted to give in the area of education and health, what I talked about, that education is totally locked down. Our DEF's educational program has not locked down and not stopped working. We work with the STEM learning in two states, in Telangana and Assam. We did not stop. All the students went home. Their teachers did not want to come online, but our facilitators created an online classes. They put the timeline, they put the schedule, and they all came, to participate learning STEMs online. Similarly, we have another program where tribal girls are, have a mentors all across the world, all across the country. They have a schedule weekly on the video call. They are going on, and the mentor and mentorship program is going on. And the girls are connected, their educational program is going on. So it is very important that education kind of thing, which actually became so much dependent on digital at this point of time and suffering because of the lack of infrastructure, must be looked at from the from the policy perspective, that how we can create a very strong digital infrastructure at the bottom of the pyramid. And the last thing that I want to say is that there are many policy things that came up. For example, we wrote to the Prime Minister and we requested TRAI and all that all the prepaid users and all the feature phone users, almost 500 to 600 million people, should be treated as the call time or the talk time or the internet time or the data time must be given free or must be given subsidized. That should be treated. So access to internet, access to data, and access to talk time must be treated to the same level of necessity and fundamental right as access to food and or the right to food. So that we have requested, and that's very, very important. Similarly, I want to request from the policy perspective that our education system must work very hard for the future to create a digital infrastructure, so that in a lockdown kind of situation or a social distancing kind of situation, our education doesn't stop. And that doesn't mean that you run the same education system, but what I'm saying is that any kind of education system should not stop and must be made capable of using digital infrastructure for the last mile. So I'll stop there and to talk more about it, but let me know if you have some points.
Great. Thank you so much, Osama. This was a wonderful presentation. DF is covering a lot of areas, which from information to food to education, a lot of things is covered under the relief program that you're doing, and it's so wonderful.
Actually, just to add, Pratyush, that for the last 4 days in Haryana, there is a highway that goes, expressway that goes, which is called KMP, Kundli,
Manesar,
and Palwal Highway. And we realized that all the migrants of Gurgaon are actually accessing that road to go to UP, Bihar, and any of the place on that side. And we have a center in Noob, which is in Haryana, and our team informed that, you know, there is a whole crisis that is visible there on that highway. So we have brought together food and the kit for all the travelers, migrants there, and we have camped there on the highway, and we are actually feeding directly and giving kit to the people who are traveling from that side. So this one is absolutely, mind-boggling from the perspective that, this brought us to work in urban areas, but this also brought us to very, very closely work with migrants issue, where we were at the moment, we are partnering with others to work in urban areas and other areas, but now we are working directly because of, you know, finding a hot spot where the people are passing by.
Yeah, that's so wonderful, and a lot of organizations are working for the migrant laborers, and that's really a very poignant crisis that you're seeing even 70 years after the Republic. So I would request everyone to keep on sending their questions, but Osama, we had a couple of questions which people posted while registering, and one of the questions was, in terms of the digital empowerment that has taken place in the country, in terms of gender, how do you see it pan out so far? I mean, before the COVID crisis, or even during the crisis, how do you see gender play a role when it comes to digital empowerment at the last mile?
So, listen, gender plays a very strong role, but unfortunately, our digital inclusion is not gender positive, you know, I would say. You know, that is as class positive, as patriarchal, as our systems are, you know, in general. So, anywhere we take digital, and I'm not saying we means we as DEF, women adapt it later. And that doesn't mean that they adapt it later. We just do not create a situation of their adaption comes first, you know. It always goes to the male first, it always goes to the father first or the brother first and things like that. It also, in terms of quality and all that, if there is one smartphone in the house, it will always be with the boy, you know. But the flip side with DEF, so out of 10,000 digital foot soldiers that DEF has created, we have 80% for them. So we have very, very, strategically kept all our foot soldiers, mostly women and girls. Our entire goal program, which I was talking about, the mentor and mentee program, is totally women program. We were part of the Internet Sati program, which is a totally women program. So because to give you a perspective, when you give a mobile in the hands of a woman, the house becomes empowered. But if you give it to a man, it either becomes a entertainment tool or a fake news propagation tool, you know. So that's the disadvantage with giving it to the male and giving it to the advantage to give you to a woman, because woman will always and always use it for a purpose, with an objective, with a goal, and not for any frivolous reasons. So as far as the approach is concerned, we must adapt the gender positive mobile penetration or digital penetration, but unfortunately the situation at the moment is not like that.
Staying on the issue of fake news, and this is one of the issues that we discussed when we first had this conversation about the webinar, there is a lot of stigma around the COVID-19, and we saw a lot of fake news coming up during the initial portions, initial times of the crisis. And you said that your foot soldiers, some 6,000 foot soldiers, are very active in disseminating information and working to, you know, to curb fake news at the grassroots level. Could you tell us a little, some instances wherein this has been happening?
So, to tell you, actually, we treat fake news, fighting fake news or misinformation, not only a digital phenomena, it's a human phenomena. We believe that unless community is ready to fight it, it's very difficult to fight it properly. So what we did is that we actually trained 500 of our, all the centers, 500 of them as a person who knows how to bust a fake news or how to identify a fake news or how to identify a misinformation. That's very important, that you should be able to identify yourself. And then most of these people create a local network of users, you know. So they do, what they do is that they immediately identify and you know, send a message to all of them that this information is actually fake and this is not correct or right. The second thing what they do is that they identify themselves among the community as that they should be reached out for any confusion or rumor or anything to check out. So they are also the people who are identified locally at a community level that this person knows what is right or what is wrong or what is correct or what is fake and what is not fake. So, you know, that's how it works. It's a three layered. So what we are at the moment doing is that we are developing a chatbot to be given one of them. And that through that chatbot, we are developing a centralized system which will feed the information from where to all the 500, 600, and then 5,000 to 10,000. And they will then further inform the rest of the community locally. And local community actually ask them. And then they will ask us back from our database and we will reply. So that's how we are actually creating a thing. But that is under process.
Sama, my next question is on education. And you said that education is also in lockdown. And given that schools, I mean, they've not yet opened schools in lockdown 2.0, and schools would remain closed for a long time. Of course, in urban areas, a lot of classes are happening online over Zoom. But what do you see? Does digital offer a solution to the education lockdown in the country or the loss of education time that our students has faced? And you talked about we just have around 40 to 50 crore smartphones in the country, and most of them are feature phones. So in that respect, how will education be resumed in the post-COVID or during the crisis or in the post-COVID world?
So I will give you a live example of three blocks in Gadchiroli. Gadchiroli is a tribal district. It is in Maharashtra, which is very backward, one of the most backward districts of the country. We have a very old digital foot soldier there who is now matured and become very big, so much big that now he also makes donation, but just that's a separate issue. But what he has done is that he has taken connectivity from panchayat and he has started laying fiber to household, to institution, to health center, to anganwadis, to schools and everywhere. So what I am actually trying to say is that it is not possible to give broadband connectivity to each and every household. That is not possible. So let's not aspire for that. But what is important is that create a local panchayat level or a block level digital infrastructure to have your institution connected, you know, or at least have the connectivity available to the people if they want to have connectivity. If you do that, your education system will never be locked down, because at the moment, the lockdown is not over when you sit in a community with a social distancing, you know. If you keep the social distancing, you can have it. I will send you a picture of, we are taking class in Barabanki of the skill training class with social distancing. You know, girls are coming, they are sitting in a room with social distancing. Just that your batches have increased because you have less number of people in one class because you are not sitting very close to each other. So those norms will be there. But the point is that at the end of it, we need digital infrastructure to connect the three part, student, teacher, and content. By the way, all these three does not require physical infrastructure. It only requires digital infrastructure. We still have content online, but do we have teachers coming online and becoming an online teacher? Perhaps not. Not because they cannot do it, because it's an attitude problem. It is just that they don't want to do this extra work because they don't want to use. Can you do your mobile? I mean, I'm using laptop at the moment, but I usually do webinar on my mobile. That's not difficult to do. Most of the students I know who have got digital access, they use mobile to access all the content. So what is decentralization of quality digital infrastructure is very, very important if you want to carry on your education without interruption.
There's one question coming in when it comes to your connectivity with your digital soldiers. How do you ensure connectivity of your foot soldiers in remote places?
So our 600 location that I said where we have a physical infrastructure, we have built the connectivity ourselves. So the connectivity is captive by us. We have taken the connectivity from somewhere else and we have brought to the village and we further distribute, or our center is totally connected. So we have a point where the connectivity is available. In rest of the individuals, where the individual foot soldiers are there, where there is no resource center, they are dependent on mobile connectivity only. But since they are mobile and they have mobility, I mean, they go to the connectivity area to get connected if they are so remote. But usually, I mean, we don't have so many places which is totally telecom dark. I mean, telecom dark, even if you live in telecom dark, within 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, 5 kilometers, you will find a connectivity. So these kind of foot soldiers usually go to that area to do their work.
And I'm curious to know, how do you identify, how have you identified and overall built this whole cadre of digital foot soldiers over the years? What has been the whole process?
We have always, I mean, we have two, three magnetic way of doing things. One is that when we go to the village, we identify local people and they help us. But over a period of time, in one of our program, which is a ENGO program, where we give a website to the people and host NGOs, and we have done about 6,000 NGOs online. They became our mega network for the country to help us to go to the ground and identify local youth to become foot soldiers. The other attractive point is that most of the places we go with assets which is given to them, so they don't spend the asset on the first instance, but at the same time they also get an opportunity to become an entrepreneur, you know? So that's the beauty.
Osama, I have a meta question about the whole digital inequality that we see in the country right now. And while we know that there's a huge gap in terms of digital inclusion and literacy, then why all the relief measures by center mostly include digital system or a formal measure such as Jan Dhan accounts? Haven't we excluded a huge segment of the population? And was this the only solution that was available?
No. Can you repeat? I missed the point.
In terms of including, there is digital exclusion in the country. The power of digital has not reached to the last level. That's but when it comes to relief measures, we're doing it through Jan Dhan accounts and a lot of digital enabled platforms or bridges.
That's
so
right.
In this process, aren't we by default excluding a lot of population? And if not this, then what could have been the solution?
Of course. We are excluding a lot of people, and we know it, and everybody knows it. I mean, people don't talk about it. But if you talk about mass level of direct benefit transfer, it is also going to be extremely corruption oriented phenomena. If you start distributing cash in the hands of the people, or start distributing food in the hands of the people, and all, you need some system, you need some register, you need some some logbook, for sure, there's no doubt about it. But in this kind of time, what government also did, and most of the states adopted, is also that they said that those people who do not have any kind of card or any nomination or any kind of authorization, they are also, would be considered to be provided with the basic needs like food and not money, certainly, but food certainly. you know, so in many places where our foot soldiers are there, I mean, many people who didn't have any paperwork, they actually created register and they went to get them ration distributed to them. And in many places, many people were not supported by local panchayat or block or state. They started collecting grains from the house who could afford it, and then cooked it and distributed it, and also distributed the grains to the people. So all three also happened, you know. So peer to peer also happened.
So continuing on that, I was curious to know, because our viewership includes corporate professionals, includes students, includes people from the social sector. Some of the organizations are right now working in COVID relief, some of them are not. So how can individuals play a role in this whole crisis? And especially, I would want to request you, in terms of digitally enabled professionals, how can individuals play a role in this crisis, in your opinion?
So there are three very clear-cut linkages that can be done. One is that one can get associated to raise funds or raise resources to distribute wherever you are, because the crisis is all over the country. It is not that you need to belong to a certain state to solve the problem or make it reach. That's number one. And resource mobilization. The second is fundraising. The third is volunteering and internship or something like that. You can say you get associated, you become another hand in support of the situation and help. But the fourth most important thing is that how you actually create a proper information system to make information valuable. You know, actually in this kind of thing, information becomes the biggest crisis. You know, information becomes the biggest crisis. And at this point of time, we have a crisis of economy, money, resources, and information. For example, how many migrants in Gurgaon are there, captured either by the industrialist and they are not releasing, or how many people are coming on the road or going? I mean, you can see nobody knows. Actually, nobody knows. I mean, look at it from the perspective of, far away. I mean, I feel that all the DTC buses are lying vacant and unused. Why can't we put all our migrants into those buses and send all over the country? But no, there is a serious issue of who will pay for it, how people will see it, how we will get recognized, how we'll register, and blah, blah. And it has already been 2 months. So certainly planning, information planning and planning, strategic planning is very, very important that one can get into. Corporates could be very, very useful, because at this point of time, every corporate is a resource itself, you know, either financially or their whole number of employees. We may not be as busy as they would be about 2 months before. And they all can actually become a very strong human resource, financial resource, to provide these resources locally or otherwise. I know many of my friends in Gurgaon, they work with the city and wherever they are working, and many people are doing it. But I see that the channelization of available resources is the biggest crisis at the time of the crisis. You know, that doesn't happen.
My next question is a contentious one. This is about the Arogya Setu app, and I wanted to know your opinion on it. While the government is pushing it as a way to control the spread of the virus, there are a lot of concerns about privacy and surveillance. I want to know your thoughts on very heated debate that's happening in the country right now.
So, three things. I don't use it. It's not on my mobile. We were the signatory with another 40-50 organization to send it to PMO and everyone to withdraw it from being mandatory. And we have succeeded, as you can see, in the fourth lockdown. Arogya Setu has been said not compulsory. I mean, it is being already said that it will help you if you do. But coming to more important, I will talk purely from government perspective and not from privacy perspective, because that will sound like I am like a, you know, crying wolf. But purely from the perspective that if government wanted an app to be utilized by each one of you so that you would be helped by identifying who could be a potential COVID affected people. That's a simple thing. Point is, you cannot do it in a country like India where the mobile app, which is based on a smartphone, whose itself penetration is less than 25-30% in the country, which requires more than 50% download and utilization to give a correct data file. You know, it is non-functional if more than 50% people do not use it and do not download it. So there is a strategic mistake in this entire thing. We don't even have that many smartphone users. Forget about a smartphone. Apparently, I came to know that this app requires high level of a smartphone because it's a higher version of Android or something that it requires. So therefore, it was just not possible. You know, you could have done it in a very strong urban center, one area where the mobile penetration is, you know, 1:3 or something. I mean, that would have been made possible. But otherwise, for the whole nation, it is not possible. You could have said that, okay, we are only doing, hot zones or red zones, or we are doing only, you know, metropolitan cities, you know, or we are doing some parts of metropolitan cities because we know the movement in that area is much higher so that we can concentrate. It's not possible. The third thing is last, which is privacy, and Indian government is known for not knowing how to keep things private. They are not. They have been, we have seen enough example of Aadhaar data being used. We have seen enough example of our various kind of data collected by various kind of people not properly kept, and it just kept open in open for anybody to copy or something. I came to know today that already people are getting video calls and with the reference of Arogya. That means that number is already started being shared, you know, or is been hacked or whatever, I don't know. So the point is that if you do not have a track record of technologically and intentionally to keep the data sanctum sanctorum that nobody would be utilized, how am I going to trust you to give my data once again? I feel that this government actually loves collecting data and information about its people by all means possible, whether it's Aadhaar or Jan Dhan Yojana or Arogya Setu or NRC or CAA or whatever. I mean, the whole approach is all the time, how do we collect maximum number of data? Because we, even if you are not sharing those data, you might be using the data for something else, you know, which I won't know that some else incident happened because of the earlier data that was collected from me, you know. You have no idea, you know, in this polarized world and communalized world and, highly misinformation and, fake news oriented world.
Isn't it ironic that on one hand, the problems that we face are of privacy and surveillance, and on the other hand, there isn't enough even reach of, there are areas where even mobile connectivity is not there, leave alone feature mobile phones and then survey and then smartphones.
There are 50,000 villages in India which doesn't have any telecom connectivity. They are totally telecom dark. Apart from that, telecom dark can be categorized in many ways. Telecom dark where not available, telecom dark when the tower is there but doesn't function, and then telecom dark because the 2G is not good enough to do any transaction or any, That's also comparatively, if government says that you do online booking, how do I do online booking? If I live in 2G era, 2G doesn't allow you to do online booking because that transaction requires higher bandwidth.
There's one question on empathy, and the question is that for a long time,
I'm not going.
Yeah. I was just, so my question, the question is that there's a, this question is on empathy. For a long time, even before the crisis, I would say India was India was ignorant of the needs of Bharat and of the cries of Bharat. And suddenly with this whole migrant crisis happening, which people say is the worst crisis of people moving from one place to another after partition, people are suddenly waking up that things are not hunky-dory. Things were not hunky-dory in Bharat in all three COVID times. Can digital play a role in empathizing people, in bringing the realities of the last person to the relatively affluent class and making them more sensitive to the realities of this country at the grassroots?
You know, digital is perhaps already doing that without intentionally trying. You know, for example, the kind of pictures and photo and the news and information of the suffering of our misdeeds are coming, that itself is actually showing the mirror to our faces. You know, we didn't know that so many poor people were living with us. You know, it's just such a big number. Second, we didn't know that we didn't want to take care of the people who built our houses, who built our homes, we built our, parks, we built our, cleaned our taxis and our cars, and who fed us, who made food for us, every kind of category. We just didn't know that we were so pathetic to them that for just 2 months we couldn't take care of them. Most of these migrants are going without being paid for the last 2-3 months. Even the last payment of the working time that they did, they were not paid. And I have a video of that I can show you. I mean, this shows, and government also showing the same attitude by diluting labor laws, you know, so that the labor laws doesn't catch them, you know, to give their rights. It's so pathetic. So certainly it's showing all over, you know, as you said that after partition, this is the largest number of people on the road walking, you know, there's no doubt about it. And in after 70 years of independence, if we have a similar situation where, you know, somebody was calculating that even 10% of all the migrant laborers are actually on the road, it is about more than 80 lakh. And gradually everyone will come on the road. And this is going to create three crises. The crisis number one is that at the human level, we didn't know how to take care of our own people, number one. Number two, these people are not going to come back very easily. So when you need them, now, next time, they may not be very easily available. Or because many of them said to me also that they are not going to come back. Number three, is that back home they don't have job, they may not have land also, you know, how will they make life themselves? But they're still going back because they think that at least there somebody will ask, how are you? Here nobody asked, actually, literally nobody asked. I mean, if you have to believe it by going and seeing them on the road, how small kids are there. I mean, I don't have to explain it. I mean, it is there all over. I mean, it is visible. I mean, people are reporting. We have captured many things. Yesterday on Sunday, I was going to Haryana. And on the way, I met four families. One was traveling back from Kashmiri Gate to Gurgaon because they didn't get the bus. And he was from the same place where I was born, which is Betia in West Champaran in Bihar. Two kids, 21-year-old. Next, I went, six people, family going on rickshaw to Alwar. After 2 months of lockdown, they lost all the money. They finally stepped out. Another family I met, six people, cycling to Gaya. And you know what? I exchanged the mobile number with them. They are all the time updating me where they are. Yesterday night they called me, they said that in Itawa, in Agra, police is not allowing them to go further. But today morning, again I talked to them, they were in Itawa and now they are going further. So imagine, and there is a lady and two kids in the, out of those 16. They were cycling. They had the courage to start cycling from Gurgaon to Gaya in Bihar, which is not less than around 1100 to 1200 kilometers or something like that. I mean, this is inhuman. I am sure if you would have given them proper food, you know, and shelter, I mean, they would pay it. I mean, why would they go? So we, number one, we didn't provide humanitarian aid or the necessity. The second thing is that we didn't provide enough resources to take them home, you know, and this is, I mean, this is common sense. I don't think it requires much bigger strategic decision to take a call. How do you shift people? Rather than giving 500 people or 1,000 rupees to the people, you could have organized a bus for them. Another family I met, they had booked a Jeep. You know how much they were paying? 5,500 per person to go to Supol in Bihar. That Jeep had 13 passengers for 70,000 rupees they were going, and each one was paying 5,500. How could have they paid 5,500, you can imagine. Most of the people who are migrating, they, if they can, they have got money from their parents or anybody from the village to them to travel back. And they came here to earn and give the money to back to the village. Rather than that, they are taking support from their own people. And all these people, by the way, were working for someone who were part of our cities and metros. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know what you are asking, and I really appreciate your question to empathy and sympathy and the challenge to humanity, you know. It is certainly exposed us hollow. What kind of people are we?
In terms of preventing, because a lot of there are assumptions and reports that a lot of gains when it comes to alleviating poverty would be washed out because of the COVID-19 crisis. What can civil society organizations, governments, and especially using digital do to prevent people falling back to poverty? Can something be done right now? Because infrastructure is not there, and that's a reality. But in terms of now, what we have, what is the best case? What is the best use of resources or the best case scenario that you feel from now on when it comes to minimizing the impact of whatever this crisis has done using digital?
To be very frank, I don't know. But what I feel very strongly is that there is no doubt that digital is not going to go away. Digital is not going to be another thing that we are going to tell that, you know, like economy, digital is not going to work. Digital is a piece of connectivity. It connects people, connect everything. It is going to be there. It has to be strengthened. It will be strengthened. It might be required to be much more cleansed, you know, in terms of misinformation and all that. But having said that, I feel that we are going for a reset kind of world, you know. We are going to push a reset button, where we might have to redefine poverty, we will have to redefine economy, we'll have to redefine affluence, we'll have to redefine market, we'll have to redefine our everything, you know. So what we called as economy, I mean, I was talking to Mr. Arun Mehra, who is advisor to DEF. He said that, human-created economy. But last several decades, economy has started using humans, you know, to alleviate itself, you know, to create its own GDP to its level. So, you know, consumption pattern keep on increasing and increasing and increasing. So today's poverty line is defined because of what you can afford and how much you can spend or how much you can consume. You know, it may be redefined, you know, that I don't spend more than what I need, and my need would be defined. You know, at the moment, our desires are also need and necessities. You know, unfortunately, TV is not a need, but I have it. In fact, I have it in maybe every room in my house or something, you know, or many people would have. So is that a need? Having more than, you know, a few number of clothes, is that a need? I mean, do we really need to earn more than 50,000 rupees or a 10,000 rupees or a 5,000 rupees? We will have to. So reset button will actually define. What is very interesting is that even if we redefine everything, will this difference of class and rich people and poor people will diminish or not is the real question. And that I don't know, because I still feel that the exploiters will always be there, the rich will always be there, the hoarders will always be there, the user of humans of the low class will always be there, and they will use class, religion, caste, all kind of system to exploit it. I feel that is what something that you know, we need to see, that whether COVID gives us opportunity to challenge that or not. You know, unless that is challenged, I don't think we are going to see a even world. You know, I know that at the moment looks like that yesterday the poorest of the poor was earning 30 rupees a day, you know, or 50 rupees a day. Now they will have 10 rupees a day or maybe even less, you know. But the point is that is middle class, which is the largest in the world as far as India is concerned, who is the biggest consumer as far as India is concerned, the world is concerned, is that going to be squeezed to become much more level playing, to redistribute the inequality? Is what something that we need to look at. But I feel that we are certainly going to have a reset.
And a follow-up question, and on this reset which you talked about, wherein you said economy would be reset and wealth would be reset and poverty line would be reset. My question is that when you started Digital Empowerment Foundation, you would have defined digital empowerment as a goal or as a vision. Would that vision also be resetted? And if yes, what would be the new definition of digital empowerment for you or for the organization?
Actually, DF was reset in 20 years before, you know. So we are finding ourselves quite vindicated that we have been working in a very right direction to serve the last mile, to serve the poorest of the poor, to digitally empower and connect those people who are always left behind. So that actually becomes more necessary now today. And in terms of if you see the reverse migration, you know, we are already there where these people are going back, you know. So, you know, so we might have to strengthen ourselves to serve these people more. What I feel is that we have to reset ourselves from the perspective that the network that we have created, how do we make it digitally more strong to become a parallel, servicing platform for all the needs for which the government or the private sector couldn't serve. You know, is that possible that if you can do? But the point is that not-for-profit is a not-for-profit. You know, we cannot work on we already are much higher scale than a typical not-for-profit organization should have been. But the point is the kind of model that we have created is the bottom, at the bottom of the pyramid, the highest level of the use of the strength of digital is required, is something that we want to teach in everyone, and they must adopt it and replicate it.
Great. Thank you so much, Osama. We're completely out of time. Thank you so much for this talk. It was really wonderful to hear your thoughts on the crisis at large and digital empowerment in particular, and also to hear about the relief program that DEF is doing. It's absolutely wonderful, and all power to you and DEF for this wonderful work that you're doing.
Thank you very much. And for everybody who are stuck listening, you have one more responsibility. Please let us know how would you like to be associated, number one. Number two, how you can contribute in our endeavors. But your contribution could be physical, mental, knowledgeable, and financial as well. So please do come forward and you know, participate and join hands with us.
Thank you so much. Thank you to all of you who participated today. It was, yeah,
thank you so much. Thank you very much.